This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to do something new and old, because we have explored many of the world religions on this show, many, many of them, but never quite like this. When I was in India in January, I went all around with my son and grandson to various cities, to Varanasi, to Jaipur, to Bombay, to Calcutta, to Delhi. We even went on a tiger hunt, and not with guns, obviously, but a tiger hunt. Didn't see any tigers, but everyone else in the that morning did. So we felt at least we'd brought others good luck. In any case, we just toured around. We went to Bodh Gaya, to the Buddhist area, and I meditated under the Bodhi tree. It's very fun, but it wasn't a. There was no spiritual content to it. We were tourists. I never thought of anything like this. Then I came home, and something just happened to me. I became involved with a Hindu goddess I knew a little bit about called Kali. And Kali turns out to be rather dangerous, to say the least. And I ended up getting involved in mantras. And as you all know, I'm not a particular believer in any religion, and I'm very much respect the teachings of Jesus. I've written a book about Jesus called Jesus, A New Vision. But I wouldn't call myself a Christian or a Catholic or a Buddhist or a Hindu or anything. But boy, was she powerful. Let's talk about Theresa. First, let me introduce Theresa. Theresa basically makes malas. She doesn't just make malas. She makes phenomenally beautiful malas. You can find her on Etsy, at Malaology, or her website is malaology.com. So if you become inspired to get a mala, this is where to go. But this isn't an infomercial. We're here for information. Okay, let's start talking about Kali. By the way, Teresa's also on YouTube, and she knows loads about, she's not just making malas. This is someone who knows what she's doing big time. So welcome to Dreamland, first of all.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here.
Good. And let's start by talking a little bit about Kali. I had known about Kali for a long time, but what happened was, first, I had a vision of this terrifying goddess. My listeners know I meditate every night, and I sometimes have visions. And during these meditations, they're not a big deal, but you know, they're usually of certain things that I'm familiar with. But then suddenly, there was this monster, and it scared the hell out of me. But I recognized it. I recognized it immediately as Kali. Then my whole life blew up. People I loved threw me out like garbage. Everything blew up. My ego was destroyed. Let's start there.
It reminds me of a story that I've heard of a guy who really, really, really wanted to see Ma Kali. So he chanted her mantra hundreds of thousands of times in his lifetime, and she never appeared for him. And he learned that if he sits on a corpse, that she'll appear for him. So he went into the jungle and sat on a corpse, put a lamp in its mouth, and chanted his mantra fervently until a tiger came and ate him up. The tiger came and ate him up.
Yes.
I know. She was fierce. She was all black with the fangs and the blood and all the things. But there was a grave digger who saw the man approaching in the nighttime and climbed up a tree out of curiosity to see what he was going to do. So he watched this whole thing unfold. He learned the Mali or the Kali mantra, and he repeated it himself. For some reason he couldn't understand, he picked up the man's mala, who was now just a pile of blood and guts, and started to repeat the Kali mantra, and she appeared before him. She didn't appear before the other man, but she appeared before him. She didn't save the other man, but she asked him, "What would you like? What can I do for you? What do you want from me?" And he asked her, "Why are you appearing here for me? And you didn't do anything for the other man who was here, like clearly to serve you." And she said, you have prayed to me for countless lifetimes. I know you. And all you had was 7 more repetitions to do before I would appear to you." So it's just, I do feel like these gods show up in our lives because of old karma, old, past lives, ancestral connections that we have. I have a similar experience myself, not with Makali, but it just reminded me of that.
Okay, I'm going to get to your experience in just a minute, but I want to unpack this a little bit more, because here these people, this guy tried for so long to get involved with Kali, and I wasn't even thinking about Kali. I knew who it was as soon as I saw it, the image, and folks, those who are on video are seeing the image about now, I think. And for those who are listening on the podcast, let me describe what they are seeing. They're seeing an image of a woman. She's sort of blue black. Her tongue is sticking out. She's got a whole lot of arms. In one of them is a headsman's knife. In the other, one of the others is a human head dripping, man's head dripping blood. She's got a necklace of skulls around her neck, and she's standing on a dead body, a man, of course. And this is, to say the least, a very disappointing thing to see when you're quietly meditating in the middle of the night. And unexpected at first. I mean, I nearly jumped out of my skin, because this was a vision and it was so vivid. It was one of these really, when I'm meditating, I don't have super vivid inner visions. I sometimes do have things happen that materialize in front of me. That's happened numerous times. And this was like a very vivid inner vision, and it felt like she was really there, and it scared the dickens out of me. And then, as I say, my life promptly fell apart. Everything that my ego treasured was immediately wrecked. This is the important part. I think it was the most valuable thing almost that ever happened to me. Okay, so that's where that is. Let's talk now. Why don't you comment on that, Theresa?
One thing sticks out, that head that Kali holds. It represents the ego, and she has decapitated the ego. And she's so thorough in doing that she has a cup that she holds, and it's full of blood. And she drips the head's blood into the cup to catch every last drop so that the blood can't fall to the earth and propagate. And then she drinks the blood, consumes it so that there's no way that it comes back. She destroys the ego. And that's one of the most powerful things that she does. And it's very exciting to hear this.
Well, it was exciting to have happened, because I thought I was doing fine until, I realized that, as my life fell apart, I live by ego. I did live by ego. I don't think I do now, but I may. And if so, I want her back, because it was an incredibly freeing experience. And it still is. I look at the way I was before it happened and the way I am now, and it's two different people. It's much more fun, for example, to go out. I was at Contact in the Desert, the UFO conference, a couple of weeks ago, and I had so much more fun than I had ever had before because I felt so open to everyone there. I wasn't kind of clinging to myself because, you know, a lot of fans come there and a lot of fans want to be with you. And previously, I would kind of hide. Not this time. This time I wanted to be out all the time. I was with everybody and I had the best time I've ever had in my life. And it was because my ego was in my pocket. Because of Collie. I just find this fascinating. That this could be, I mean, I don't know what are these gods? Are they real beings or what are they?
They're real beings, to be certain, they are real beings, but they are the elements that make up the universe. They're at the beginning, Vedic cosmology mirrors science in so many ways. So when I say some of these things, it's really just a reflection of what we know about the macrocosm and microcosm. I'm just going to say that. So I don't sound too woo-woo. You know?
Yeah.
But we could say that the whole universe is made up of elements that were created at the beginning. And each one of these is a sound, a resonance. And Kali has a resonance. It's cream. Cream, cream, cream. This is her bija mantra, her seed mantra. And so that's a thing. That's just a frequency and a thing. But as above, so below, as within, so without. God manifests in infinite ways. And I'm just like you. I'm not a religious person in any way, shape, or form. And I'm very, very open to all thought systems and beliefs. And I find that they all say the same thing. They're all very, very similar. Maybe not all of them. But they, you know, they're all resonating because they're all resonating with the same elements, right? And Kali, there's a lot to this element. Kali is dark matter, dark energy, for instance, right? And she's very, very special and extremely intense. And I consider myself an intense person. I am, Kali hasn't called to me and I am not going to go there, but I will say the gods in general, they're resonances, frequencies, but they are beings and they do make themselves known to you, whether in the personification of say a Hindu god or some other god guiding guard. It could be, you know, an angel, dark matter, you know, there's just so many ways to look at them.
Yeah, that's right. And they're not, the other thing about the Hindu deities that interests me is their complexity.
Yes.
They are very, very complex. The stories of the Hindu deities are the stories of the human psyche and all of its conflicts and all of its aspirations. And all of its dangers and all of its loves. They're all in the stories of these deities. They're much more complex than the old Western gods, the classical Western pantheon. And their imagery is also, that's what all of the arms are about and the incredibly complex imagery. Those are very strange looking things, these statues. Can you talk about, let's talk a little bit about all of the arms and why they have those arms.
This, you know, and I'm just going to back up real quick. And okay, we'll talk about the arms because they're holding all these implements and tools, right? They all started as abstract energies, which was originally thought of as Brahman, kind of like the Tao, that which can't be named, the thing that makes up everything, just potential. But these resonances were mantras. That's from the very beginning, they were sounds that created the universe. And we know that the universe is made of sounds and frequency. We are not really solid here. We're just by vibration. So there were some people who understood what these sounds were early on, and they were called Brahmin. And they were basically the people who knew the magic words. And they were the first ones to use malas. And then Brahmin and Brahman began to personify the energies, these abstract energies all around the universe, and it became Brahma, the creator God who created all things in this neighborhood of the universe, our neighborhood of the universe. And so Brahma and all of these other gods started to, we wanted to personify these energies, and so we found symbols for them, right? So Brahma was born of Vishnu, who is literally at the center of our galaxy, right? From a lotus, and Vishnu's called Vishnu Nabhi, which is a lotus, which is really just an explosion in the middle of the galaxy. And Brahma is born to create matter. And so his iconography of Vishnu is he's holding what looks like a discus, but it's really a galaxy, right? So all of these symbols represent, it helps people to remember different aspects of the god and to connect with different energies of their gods. The most interesting one to me is Lord Ganesha, because Ganesha is the god of wisdom, knowledge, enlightenment. And if you look inside of your brain, you will see almost an exact replica of Ganesha. There's a stem in your brain. I think it's called the medulla oblongata.
The medulla oblongata. Yes, I'm familiar with this. And yeah. It's remarkable because Ganesha, folks, and we're going to, let me just make a note here. We'll have an image of Ganesha up on the site. Okay. I've completely forgotten the breaks. That's typical.
Oh, no.
Oh, well. Well, okay. Now, what we're going to do now, though, first for the free side, we're going to take a break. And I don't think they've made a commercial yet for my book of poems. And I am going to urge you, since there have only like 5 copies sold so far, they're wonderful, beautiful poems. And look at the couple of reviews that are on Amazon and go and explore a hidden garden. That's my book of poems. Now, I'm also going to urge you to go to malaology.com and explore Theresa and her work, obviously. She's a very advanced individual with this material, long past the belief level and into deep understanding of something that is incredibly valuable. So visit malaology.com. We'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories, into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives. We're talking to Theresa Mayville. Theresa's website is malaology.com. She's also on Etsy under the word malaology. And we were talking just before we left the air about Ganesh and the fact that the brainstem and medulla oblongata look like this god with this sort of elephant-like trunk. What is going on here? Teresa, do you have any theories about why this particular deity reflects something inside the brain? Could that be, Teresa?
There are a lot of possibilities, and nobody really knows the truth, but it feels to me that humans were created in the image of God. So this is one of the aspects of source, of creation, is intelligence, divine intelligence, and we reflect that. Another possibility is that a long, long, long time ago, people studied the human body, and they, you know, looked into someone's brain, and they saw what it looked like, and they thought it maybe looked like an elephant, and they named a god after that elephant. Another possibility, I see Ganesha as like Jupiter. He clears the obstacles. Jupiter clears obstacles from us, blesses us, is really, really big. There's a lot about Jupiter, actually, that resonates with Ganesha for me personally. And I believe that this is really getting out there.
But go ahead. That's where we live.
But as humans evolved into material beings, we evolved through the planetary energies of our solar system.
So we have, I'm still thinking, I use ChatGPT here to look at the medulla oblongata and its functions. And it seems to be mostly like physical functions. In other words, it's nothing to do, much to do with the emotions. It's digestive processes, coordination of movement, swallowing, heart rate, and blood pressure. So it doesn't seem to be related to the exact function of this deity. But tell us about Ganesha and what Ganesha does.
Well, there's a little bit more there too. You know, it looks like the crown he has looks like there's right in the center the pineal gland, if I am not mistaken.
That's right. It's true. Yeah.
Yep. And there's two hemispheres there with his ears. So really, you know, there's a lot there. Lord Ganesha is he's considered like the prince of the Ganas, and the Ganas are these beings that are not human, that were actually considered aliens. And his father gave him an elephant head after he chopped his head off, and then named him the king of the Ganas, or the prince of the Ganas, the ruler of the Ganas. And that's where he got his name Ganesha, or Ganapateye. So.
And why did his father do this?
Well, Ganesha is very brave and powerful, and he was protecting his mother. She was bathing, and he didn't know his father when his father came home. And so you can't pass here in the, you know.
And the father got annoyed.
Yes.
I understand. So, and that's typical of these stories. A lot of the stories in this in this pantheon and its relationships with each other are pretty violent, and they reflect the intensity of the emotional world of the inner world of man to a great degree. The Greek gods too, but the Greek gods, interestingly enough, are much more they're much more about the psychology of relationships. If you read the stories of the Greek myths, you're reading basically ancient soap operas about families. But if you read these stories, you're reading about energies, very intense internal energies exploding out in all sorts of different ways. Here, this young man is shielding his mother from an intruder, not knowing it's his father. And the lack of information is characteristic of the whole pantheon. People are constantly doing things because they don't know the whole story, or they are under a misapprehension. It's absolutely, I've read a great deal of this material, and it's very interesting in this respect because it's a little closer to the reality of human experience. We are often acting out of basically ignorance. Where did these gods come from? What are the earliest indications of their presence where does Hinduism begin?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know if a Hindu could tell you where Hinduism began. There's no central authority, so it's not really a religion. There's a lot of reasons it's not an actual religion. It's just a group of sects and cultures, lifestyles. There's a lot to it, though, and you're right, it's extremely intricate. So I would say 2,500 years ago, 2,000 years ago, the Sanskrit language was given to people in India, and the texts that followed, the Vedas, the Puranas, the Mahabharata. I mean, these are some prolific texts. So where do they come? Great question. I mean, the Mahabharata says that these were, and my understanding of it is that these were people that came from other planets and fought wars on our planet.
And there's a lot of indications in our world that there were builders here who built things that are beyond our skills today, and also that something happened around 12,000 years ago on this planet that was very violent. We know that happened, but what was it? I mean, we've assumed it was some kind of natural phenomenon, but what if it wasn't? What if it was these wars?
Their history texts actually say that they were wars and that is what happened. So 12,000 years ago, 12,000 BC was my understanding. There's a historian, his name is Nilesh Oak, and he's really good at reading these texts, and they're wise enough to say, not in this year or that year, but when this comet was passing in front of this planet and there was an eclipse in this part of the sky and there was a conjunction here of these planets, this happened. So you can backtrack according to astronomy and astrology and find what those dates were. So
can you spell his name? Because I know a lot of my listeners are going to want to look him up.
Absolutely. Nilesh, Nilesh Oak, OAK. And he would be considered something like the Graham Hancock of India.
Great. Nilesh Oak.
Yes.
All right. We've got something to explore there.
Yes. And so he looked at the Mahabharata, which discusses this great war that happened, and the Ramayana, which is another great war that happened. And his estimations is the Ramayana happened 14,000 years ago, and the Mahabharata happened 7,000 years ago. So these were wars that culminated. I don't know what the Mahabharata says, but I know that the Ramayana says, but I know the Mahabharata says that there was a nuclear explosion and that it leveled everything. There was a pillar of ash. Everything was burnt to a crisp immediately within, you know, miles. And the people that survived on the periphery had boils on their skin and their hair and nails fell out. So yes, yeah, something powerful absolutely happened.
Well, you know, there are areas of the Middle East where they found trinitite, which is this is the mineral that is, it's called trinitite because the Trinity bomb explosion when the first atomic bomb was exploded experimentally in New Mexico at the Trinity site, a kind of glass was left under the bomb area made of the sand, and it was called trinitite. And then they proceeded to find trinitite in areas of the Middle East. And it was been explained away, because we're very good explaining things away that we would rather not be true, because they don't fit our expectations or assumptions about the past, as something caused by incoming asteroids. But the problem is that the heat of an atomic explosion is much greater than the heat of an asteroid impacting the Earth. And the further, there's no impact area. In other words, it's like an explosion took place, but there was no impactor, nothing fell. That is to say, it looks like these are points where atomic bombs exploded.
Absolutely. And the books will literally tell you that there were, in the Mahabharata, there wasn't just nuclear explosions, but there were 46 different weapons outlined. 46 different weapons. And these were very modern weapons, like stealth fighters that could disappear, nerve gas that would immobilize people, drones that shot lasers and heat-seeking missiles.
Yes. Now, here's an interesting question. Can we imagine something that has never existed in our understanding of the world? In other words, and this gets back to Ezekiel's wheel, could he have just imagined that? And the answer is, it's really very difficult. Try it now, folks. Try to imagine something functional, real, that doesn't exist at all in your mind. And you'll find you can't do it. Like Ezekiel had never seen anything like that. He couldn't have. And yet he's describing it. Remarkable. And the only thing you could do maybe is if you use drugs, you could do it possibly. But still, whatever you created in your imagination would refer to the world that you knew in some way. And these don't. They don't refer in any way to the world as it was then. I find that absolutely fascinating. And listen, speaking of fascinating, we're taking another break. We'll be back in a minute.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. Unknowncountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field. And when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system. It energizes the solar system as you have things going into the sun. Even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun. It will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age in approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year.
We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to unknowncountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started.
We're talking to Theresa Mayville, a real fascinating, interesting expert on a lot of things to do with the Hindu deities and their significance in the world, a maker of beautiful malas. I have two of her malas myself. I lost one of them somehow, and she's sending it me a replacement very sweetly of her. And so if you go to malaology.com or go to her shop on Etsy, Malaology, you'll find her malas, and they're really, if you're interested in doing these mantras, and which have become very interesting to me, then I give her a look. Well, let's talk a little bit more about the wars, and because I think they may have happened, and they may be the explanation that, for example, we don't have a single trace of any tool that was used to craft many of the remarkable objects in Egypt or to build the great stone edifices that are there. There's no illustrations of them. There's no remains of any of them at all. In other words, they took their tools home with them. Is that possible, do you think? I think so. Go ahead.
I think so too. In fact, their history tells us that a god helped them to build. I'm not sure which one it was. It may have been Tahote or Thoth, but taught them how to actually do this, or, you know, brought his technology there. So, you know, they literally say that this was, you know, maybe the Egyptians don't, but the hieroglyphics.
No, they sort of do, and the Sumerians certainly do. The Sumerians speak very carefully about the gods that came to them. And speaking of Graham Hancock, who we referred to briefly earlier, that the Viracochas in Mesoamerica and Quetzalcoatl in Mexico were all bringers of wisdom from some other place. And it's almost as if some catastrophe happened. Perhaps a war was fought here that had nothing directly to do with us. We were only collateral damage. And then after, people came to us from other worlds to try to help us put ourselves back together again because we had been unfairly treated. I don't know. That's a possibility.
It is a possibility. I of note, in India, the largest, oldest dam, I forgot what it's called, but the oldest dam is the largest dam, or the oldest ancient dam is the largest dam. And usually people will see a dam and they'll be like, oh, that's a great dam. I'm going to make a better one or a bigger one. It was a long, long, long time before anything like that had been built again. And the same thing with the ancient cave temple. I also forgot what the name of that was, but the largest one is the oldest one, and nothing like that has been or had been seen since for a really, really, really long time. So like you said, there is a forgetting, a disappearing, and that would happen. You know, I absolutely feel that we are a species with amnesia for so many reasons. I got my bachelor's degree in history here at Oakland University, and all the way through my education, I was never offered once in any of the classes that I got to select anything on India. That wasn't even an option for me while getting my degree. There is a lot of ignoring too, you know, as well as this forgetting. So
yeah, that comes from the colonial era, and a disdain for India and for India's contribution, cultural contribution to the world, that the Indian gods or the Hindu gods are absurd. And I felt that when I was in India, I was sort of snickering at these temples and their luridly colored, crazy looking figures inside and so forth. But I stopped snickering when Kali blew my life up. So let's move on now. I want to talk a little bit about another mystery from the deep past, which is Sanskrit. I have gotten into Sanskrit a little bit, just a tiny bit, because I when I was writing Jesus, A New Vision, I brushed up my Greek, which I had known as a boy, and not so much my Latin, because I didn't need it for that book. And I learned a bit of Aramaic, which is a very simple language. Sanskrit is awesome. I think it's the most subtle, complex language in the world. And it's, tell us a little bit about its history insofar as we know it.
Honestly, I don't know. I can't claim a lot of knowledge on this. I'm so very humbled with everything that has to do with Indian Hinduism. But I can say that I feel that Sanskrit has a lot also to do with the number 108. There are 54 letters. There's a male and a female aspect. And Shiva and Shakti are everything to do with 108. So they say it's a perfect language, and that the people who created programming language that made computers, you know, based it off of Sanskrit. So I'm not sure if that's true, but I haven't heard otherwise. That's all I can really say.
Well, I wouldn't be surprised, because it's an absolutely awesome language. I set out, there's a great mantra that you know, and I know, the Gayatri mantra, which is, tell us a little bit about it. I'm sure you know it well.
You know, the reason I know this mantra, I'm not one to memorize long strings of words. And so I will just say this to the audience. These mantras can seem intimidating, but if you listen to YouTube videos and just loop them and listen to it over and over again, and there are sometimes there's like 8 hours of these mantras being spoken, you can just hear it, the mantra will become a part of you, and it will be very, very easy for you to remember it. It's just a part of you, right? The Gayatri mantra is so very interesting, because it, from my understanding, we live in a neighborhood of 14 planets, and really this is a part of who we are and our soul's evolution to the evolutionary journey of the soul, from the lower realms to the higher realms to the heaven that we aspire to. And this mantra helps you to evolve or to enlighten yourself, to raise your frequency. This is the energy that, you could say, some would say, is required for you to not have to be reborn in this realm.
The mantra goes, Om Bhur Bhuvasva Tat Savitur Varenyam Bargo Diva Dimahi Diyo Yona Prachdoya. It means, it starts with Om, the primordial sound, then we honor or meditate upon the divine light of the God that is conscious light. I would say, although it's often translated as the sunlight, who directs us and inspires our intelligence. This is a very old mantra. Also incredibly sophisticated. This is not something that was thought up around a fire in a jungle. This is something that was created by a highly evolved spiritual culture. Who were they? Can you even speculate? Because I can't.
You know, I can't speculate. I can't. But there were the wise ones. the original seven rishis, who I often liken to the archangels. And they were the original seers of these mantras. They were the ones that were able to pluck out the sounds, the vibrations of the elements throughout the universe and bring them together for purposes that would, for many purposes, really, right? And they gifted them to us. So who were they? I the best thing I can say is I feel like they were like angels.
And we just touched on this a few minutes ago. They were there around the world in different forms. They were there in Mesoamerica, in Mexico, in the biblical world. They were all over the place, and they brought this to India. They brought the most sophisticated language in the world. I know a lot about languages, and there's nothing close to Sanskrit. And it's also certainly the oldest it's a very old language, very, very old. And yet the level of subtlety of the way the words work and the shadings of meaning that appear when you string words together in Sanskrit is just absolutely amazing. It's astonishing. I know a fair amount about hieroglyphics as well. And this language is it is more subtle than hieroglyphics and more capable above all of expressing extremely powerful, subtle, spiritual philosophy. It's amazing. I'm learning it slowly but surely.
Wow.
I love things like that. And I love the way it sounds and it feels on the tongue. God, it's wonderful to say. You know, you can, folks, if you want to, go on YouTube and look up Sanskrit and Sanskrit chants. I'll put some links on the show page that you can go to listen to some. There's a lady, an English lady, who took Sanskrit at Oxford, of all places, and is the best Sanskrit speaker on YouTube, in my opinion. And she's got some wonderful videos. She also has a Sanskrit course, which I bought, and that's how I'm learning it. In any case, let's move on now to the mala itself. This 108 bead object, you're wearing a mala around your neck. Why don't you show us the mala? And
I have one on my wrist too. So a mala will generally have a larger bead called a guru bead or a miru bead and a tassel, and then 108 beads. That's a very simple representation of a mala. Sometimes they won't have a guru bead and a tassel. They'll have a charm to help you keep track of your mantras. And sometimes it won't be 108 beads. It'll be less. 27 is a quarter mala. 54 is a half mala. 81 is a three-quarter mala, and a full traditional mala is 108.
But it always comes down to that number, 108.
Absolutely.
That you understand, and you know this, right, because it's in your Malology 101 thing that you send out when you sell somebody a mala. Here's some facts, which Teresa describes as fun facts. But they blew my mind. It blew my mind. Okay, let's number 108, folks. The diameter of the Earth times 108 is the diameter of the Sun. The diameter of the Sun times 108 is the distance between the Earth and the Sun. The diameter of the Moon times 108 is the distance between the Earth and the Moon. Okay, whoever created this created a mnemonic device so we wouldn't forget the design and structure of our own solar system. Where, how far back do the first mollusks go? Where are they first mentioned, Theresa?
Okay, so officially they'll say the 8th century BC, and those would have been used by the holy men in India to help them keep track of their mantras. Sometimes they would do hundreds of thousands of mantras in a short period of time. They have these things called sadhanas. They're usually 40 days. And I believe that Jesus did a sadhana before he became guru or teacher. That's what you generally do, is you follow that 40-day where you fast, you meditate, you do mantra, you go up to the mountains by yourself, sacrifice things of yourself. And so, you know, now we have Lent where people reflect that. They don't, I think a lot of them don't understand where that came from, right? So, but that's what it originally was made for. But the beauty of it is you can practice your mala mantra. You can count your blessings on your beads. You can speak your mantra. You can use it however you will with your intentions. And then you can wear your blessings or wear your mantra, wear your prayers with you throughout the day. And it's an extraordinary device. But can I say something too about that 108?
Yeah, please.
Excellent. So it is true. It's true that these measurements were known. These measurements were published in different Puranic texts in India. In 400 BC, the measuring rules that would tell you how to measure orbits and distances of planetary bodies were published. And then in 700 BC, the distances of the sun and the moon and their sizes were actually also published. But with these sayings were also published. 108 is the basis of all life, or 108 is the basis for all existence. And it's interesting, this 108, because the sun and the moon look like the same size from our perspective here on Earth, even though the sun is much, much farther away and much, much larger. But they look like the same size. If they looked different, if the moon looked larger, we would have a problem because the moon would be much closer to the Earth. And the moon regulates the waves, or the tides and our hormones, the axial tilt, all kinds of things. If the moon appeared smaller, it would be farther away. We could lose our axial tilt. Our gestation periods are based on lunations, on lunar cycles. A human baby is gestated for 10 lunations, 280 days. And even though other animals don't have exact lunations, they're still based on the moon's cycle. Fertility is based on the moon cycle. So that's real important. And the same with the sun. If the sun looked larger than it does, it would be closer. Life, it would be inhospitable for life if it was too close. And if it looked smaller, we would not have the blessing of the light and the warmth that the sun gives us that makes life hospitable. So really, 108 is the basis of life on Earth when you take our luminaries into account. And another saying that they have is that your body is always 108 units from the God within. And so this really is as within, so without, always. This is your relationship to your luminaries. Shiva has two eyes, actually three eyes. He has a third eye, but the sun and the moon are his two eyes. They look like the same size, right? Shiva is just a big one for me right now, but it's very, very interesting that they knew these things in 400 and 700 BC. When we measured the distance to the sun in 1650 AD, that's when we measured it.
It's just remarkable.
It is. And guess what? Here is a fun fact, another fun fact. Can you guess when we measured the diameter of the sun accurately? What date we measured the diameter of the sun with accuracy?
with the same accuracy that they had?
Yes.
When?
2003. And you know, yeah, we had to use a spaceship to do it. We put a spaceship in space and it watched Mercury transit across the sun. It was actually 2003 and 2006. We with a spaceship, we watched Mercury transit the sun, and we were able to figure out finally the accurate diameter of the sun. So,
you know, this gets me back to this war in space, this distant time, and this, because somebody apparently did have the ability to make measurements like that then, way back. And maybe that somebody did was able to do that because they could do the same thing, because they were able to move in space. God, who were they, Teresa? What a weird world. And you know, you probably know about my book Communion, and I've had lots of close encounters, and there is a profound conflict in that world. It's very deep. And for example, there's a crop formation called the Crabwood Formation that was laid down in England in 2002 that has a disc in it, in that was intricately created in the crop. And the disc has ASCII code on it, and you can read that disc, and it says beware the bearers of false gifts and their broken promises. There is good out there, much suffering, but still time. And that the bearers of false gifts, I have a feeling, might be the ones that the governments have all cozied up to because they're looking for weapons and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And the good out there means that there's somebody who I think is in touch with little guys and people like me, I'm a little guy, who has the better interests of mankind at heart. So the conflict is still there. It's not gone.
Do you know about the Lokas, the 14 Lokas?
No.
Okay.
We've come to what is usually the end of the free part of Dreamland, but I can't cut you guys off. That's cruel. It's sadistic. This is so cool. So we're just going to take a commercial break here, and then we're going to go on. And Teresa's going to pick up with this. I'm just having a fabulous time. I hope you are too. Okay, Teresa, let's go on. You were just going to...
Oh, yes. Yeah. So this is very, very interesting. This is a part of the Rig Veda. This was written maybe 1500 BC, so 3,500 years ago, around. The Rig Veda outlines a lot of Vedic cosmology. And something really interesting is it names 14 planets, 14 lokas. There are seven below us and seven above us. And there are other groups of planets. This one was made by our Brahma. And there are countless other Brahmas out there making countless other lokas. So these lower lokas have life forms that are reptilian. The very lowest one is ruled by reptiles. Some call them snakes. The serpent around Shiva's neck is the king of those reptiles. And so, you know, you have your reptilians. And then all of these lower planets are very, very materialistic. And, you know, I think, again, that this understanding, this wisdom is known in other cultures. Maybe it was passed along from India to Christians, but they often mention like the seventh heaven, the seven levels of heaven, the seven levels of hell, that kind of thing, right? So the higher planets are the more enlightened planets. And these are where the gods, the better gods, or you could say, all of these are called devatas. They'd all be considered gods by men here on earth because they had supernatural powers, things that we couldn't do. But the planet right above us, right above this loka that we're on, has what's called 33 million gods. 33 million gods. And those are just beings that have supernatural powers. So there are, all, you know, where Shiva lives, where Vishnu lives, where all of these other beautiful divine Hindu gods are said to reside in these higher lokas. But it's just interesting because these lower lokas and the higher lokas do fight with each other. They have different goals, intentions for us on Earth, you could say. And sometimes they battle it out here. So,
you know, you can internalize them and make them. And when you do that, you realize that this is a reflection of of the human psyche. It's a reflection of the heart of the matter, of the heart of man, of humanity. And these conflicts are our souls struggling to find themselves. It's simply fascinating. I want to go on now to a little bit of the math of the mala. And do not turn off your radio or go away because I said the word math. This is really fascinating because it is about something that many of you know, and you can listen to out the wazoo on YouTube, the 432 hertz frequency that is the natural frequency of the universe. Divide it by four and you get 108. 432 times 432 is 186,624. That is to say, just about exactly the speed of light. And the base of the Great Pyramid, one entire length of the base is about this, it reflects also the speed of light, as I recall. I may be wrong about that, but I don't think so. So what are we doing here? We've got this number 108 that we use in to express a mantra. And it's also, not only does it reflect the design and structure of the solar system, but the basic math of the universe itself. What are we dealing with, Teresa? It's a rhetorical question. I'm not asking you to explain this mystery, but wow.
Absolutely. And like you said, when you start practicing it, it changes you. It changes you.
It does.
Yes. It's a very, very, very powerful technology. I can't explain it other than, you know, it brings you, like you just said with the lokas, it brings you within where the truth resides, where your true connection to source is. It's like that 108 steps between you and the God within. You can't understand it. You can only just do it, you know. There's a closed book and an open book, and the open book is all the gurus, all the wisdom, which you learn from other people. And then the closed book is what you find when you close your eyes and you just listen and you just sit and you allow truth to form in your life, you know.
And it does come. This is such a rich universe and it's so ready to help us. It really is. Now, You also mentioned spiritual 108 representing spiritual enlightenment in numerology. I don't know much about numerology, so could you expand on that a little bit? 9 by 12 enlightenment and awakening as a result of cyclical completion. What does that mean?
I don't remember when I wrote that what I was thinking, because okay. My understanding has evolved so much past those basic numerology concepts. Mm-hmm. I can Yes. I wish that I had the paper in front of me. I just, you know, want to say, though, that, and I used to not be a fan of this, separating the numbers out, 108, mm-hmm. 108, because to me, 108 is a whole number, and it represents right. something itself. But 108 really is, to me, a very, very powerful visual now that tells me something else completely. The Shivalingam, you know, one is that pillar of fire that is Shiva, that is the male, the phallus of the universe, the creative energy, our sun. And then O is the yoni, is the void, is the feminine receptacle of creation. And eight is infinite and how it never ends. It's the toroidal field of creating, destroying. And it's also the vesica Pisces, where the universe is born in the cosmic egg, right in the middle there. And, you know, I've been meditating on 108 and, you know, I'm kind of stuck there. I'm stuck there. The Shivalingam is said to be the very first thing that is created and the very last thing that exists. And that makes sense to me because the vesica Pisces is the very first thing that's created. It's what an egg looks like when it separates. And, you know, I understand creation itself started with a point in the void that became aware of its limitation and went to the edge of its expanse and became another point in the void. And therefore you had two circles that intersected and made the vesica Pisces. From there, all sacred geometry was born and all creation was born. And, you know, without getting too far out there, you know, that's what I'm feeling. I'm feeling it's Shiva and Shakti and the unending creative impulse of the universe. And, you know, people may not be like, 108, you know, I don't really want to create something. I don't want to manifest something. I don't want to draw something into my life. But the truth is, the work works on you. I started out wanting to manifest something. I would do my mala mantra wanting to bring something into my life or change my life somehow. And it's like it tricks you. Sure, we'll change your life. We'll give you what you want. And then it changes you. Changes what? It changes everything about your desires, what you value, what you see. Everything. Yes.
Yeah. So. Yeah, I had the same experience. I started doing the Kali mantra, Om Krim Kale Kaya Namaha, to make my thoughts stop, because I had, of all I had lost, I was just getting, the reason this was so horrible in this bust up of this relationship was that this young woman is a genius, and she, to give you an idea, I wrote my book Them in 2 weeks, sitting at her kitchen table in her house. And that happened because she was working in her own work. She had a job and on her computer. And I would just, every once in a while, I'd read a paragraph or so, and she'd just off the cuff say things that completely clarified everything. And no one has ever done that before. It was like a miracle. And then it came to do the next book. And I thought, boy, I've got a real supporter here. Wonderful. And I sent her an email or a text saying, you know, let's get started on the new book. And she said, I can't work with you anymore. And that was because of what I had said to her and her father, but I was honor bound to say it. I didn't feel it was appropriate not to, even though it destroyed me almost completely, because I don't lie and I don't conceal. I will not do that. And then I had the mantra. I had the Kali. Kali came into my life. I had the Kali mantra. And I found that the mantra stopped this constant roaring internal agony that was going on in me. I was so grateful for it. So grateful I had met this terrifying being who's, you see the past the terrifying being, and there's like this incredibly enriching, supportive presence that's there too. That's just all very fascinating to me. So where do you go from here? What is your journey now? We're sort of coming toward the end of the show. What does this mean to you now?
You know, I have to say that I am, you know, I've made a little bit of an evolution from Ganesha to Lakshmi and now Shiva. I can hear Shiva's mantra in my head while I'm going about my business. Just came to me out of nowhere. All of a sudden, the Shiva mantra was just reverberating with me all the time. And I feel like, you know, so many of us have past lives in India. India is an old country, and mantra has been spoken for a long time in India. Maybe much, much longer than 3,000-5,000 years. You know, so I think that we all have a history with mantra. And so I'm leaning into Shiva right now, and I feel deeply comforted by that. And I feel like once you start, you know, it does just come to you. The next step will just come to you, and it will just be given to you. And so, and really, you know, I mean, again, you know, it doesn't sound like we're not religious, does it? It doesn't sound like that. So, but I just, you know.
No, I'm not, as I say, I'm not religious, and this is not about belief, any of it.
No.
It's not about belief. It's about being. And it's quite a different thing.
It is.
Quite a different thing. And, you know, it's always been that way. I think religion was invented after this material. In other words, the religions around all of the gods and so forth came after the gods, not before. I think they were structures that people began to maybe try to have power over others. Am I going in the right direction here?
No, you are. You absolutely are. 100%, absolutely. Like, this really did start as almost magic. There are formulas. You know, drink this, do these mudras, say these words, and this will happen. And it's like a technology. It's a technology that we've forgotten, or that, you know, maybe we've misinterpreted in some ways over time. We give things different meanings, but it started out as a technology that gave you a science for how to manifest certain things or to get healing or whatever. And over time, you know, there were, you know, even, and I definitely don't want to say, you know, that there, I definitely don't, there are always people like the Brahmin who knew the magic words. Other people didn't, right? So you had to come to them for an understanding. So,
In Catholicism, you have to go to the priest for forgiveness. And then that's the thing that I find fairly creepy, actually, because it's power over. And it just isn't there's something off there to me.
So
because there's no one with power over me but me. And Collie, please.
Yes. I mean,
I would end up with Collie. My wife wouldn't be surprised in the least. She'd say, that's got to be your goddess, Whitley. It's perfect for you. But beyond that and behind that, there is all of this power. You speak of magic, and they knew the magic words. But what is magic to you?
To me, magic is science that we don't yet understand. You know, there we have lighters we can start a fire with. 200 years ago, they would have thought that was magic, right?
Yeah.
So it really is just using the earth and the cosmos and our body. Our body is the biggest magical device imaginable.
Yes.
And yes. So it's using what we have to have a desired outcome. And, you know, using magic, using the word magic is just for lack of a better word. It's just, you know, if you read some of these older texts, they will, you know, they will sound like a grimoire. You know, they will tell you, you need these specific herbs in this specific proportion, and you need to do it during a full moon. Literally, it sounds like a grimoire. But people have lived according to these prescriptions for a very, very, very long time, and it's worked for them consistently.
Well, you know, I know a man who knows a lot of these prescriptions and uses them, and they do work. They do work, and I've talked to him a lot about, I've seen them work. What does it mean that these prescriptions work? And he says it's because they come into a balanced relationship with powers that are abroad in the world. And I thought that was the most interesting definition of magic I've ever heard by someone who actually can do it. Powers that are in relationship with, or in symbiosis, I think he said, with powers that are abroad in the world. Amazing. And they knew these things. And maybe we better find out what they did know, because our planet is getting into a pretty awkward situation, and we may need to go beyond where we are with modern science in order to save ourselves. And this may be the beyond we need to go to, I think. Okay. All right. Gosh, what an interesting conversation this has been. Let's talk about, you know, your literature is full of fascinating stuff about the significance of all of these different earth, the energies of things, like all of the different types of wood that you make malas of, and the different stones and so forth that you make malas of. And you know an awful lot about this, and it relates very much to the magic I just talked about. You tell us a little bit about the relationship between a mala and what it's made of.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, the material of a mala is symbolic. So there's a lot of symbolism there, but there also is a definite energy in the materials of your mala. So red raksha, for instance, red raksha seeds are filled with energy, and they're just seeds from trees that grow in the Himalayas, and they're called the tears of Shiva, right? But you can feel the energy of red raksha. I think one of your malas is red raksha, if I'm
yes, that's correct.
Yes. So it's really a holy material. Crystal develops. Gemstone crystals develop over a long period of time. And with, you know, with certain colors, with certain minerals that give them certain colors and that kind of thing. They resonate with different chakras in your body. The red rakshas have different faces, different mukhis. They will resonate with different chakras in your body. The knots in between the beads represent the commitment and the prayers and what you put into your mala mantra. Really, you know, there is a lot in the anatomy of a mala, but the tassel, I think, is the most remarkable part of it. A lot of people will have charms on their mala instead of a tassel, like this one, and that's fine and beautiful, but the tassel represents the lotus. And the lotus grows up from Malkuth, the very bottom of the Kabbalistic tree of life, where murky bottom of a pond, and it's deep manifest densified reality, and that's beautiful too. That's what we are. We are densified manifest reality. But then it comes up and opens up on the surface of the water as this beautiful blossom. So your tassel is the roots of the lotus, and also your crown chakra, which is the lotus flower, which opens up to divine wisdom, and it's the top of the tree of life as well. So your mala represents everything about your journey, your spiritual journey, and your spiritual evolution to enlightenment and connection to source. So the materials that you choose are really personal. You know, I started out thinking that a mala like this would represent me so much better. It's light and pretty and bright, and, you know, moonstone and rose quartz, love and light. And then once I started working with mala, I found that the grounding of jasper and obsidian and those darker gemstones was so much more meaningful to me and powerful, and I could really truly feel that grounding energy, and it gave me comfort, and I realized that's what I needed. So it's a good idea to experiment with different materials and just kind of, you know, open your mind to different possibilities of different materials.
What was the one you were holding up? Was that quartz?
Oh, yeah. This is moonstone and rose quartz.
Yeah. They're beautiful. The mala I respond to most strongly is dragon's blood wood, which, as it says here, is super protective, healing, and empowers magical abilities. And I need those. I live in a very strange world, quite different from most. And I don't want to talk about this because various reasons you don't talk about it, but magic is real. That's all I want to say. And so a wood that something that empowers magic is very important to me. Okay, gosh, we've come pretty much to the end of our time together, Theresa. I think this has been just such a wonderfully enjoyable show. It really fascinated me. Theresa, thank you so much for being with us. Dare I say the fact that I am talking to a very holy human being here. I know it very well, and I'm so grateful for your time.
Thank you so much. I'm so blessed to be here and just blessed to have you in this world with me.
Well, may we meet one day. It would be fun.
Yes.
Bye now, and thank you. And thank you, everyone, for being with us. And hey, those of you who are on the free side, will you please subscribe to Unknown Country for once? I would be so appreciative.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.